McLaren Honda, first in the Constructors' Championship with 139 points. Car 1, Ayrton Senna, champion with 96 points. Car 2, Gerhard Berger, fourth with 43 points. Looking back at the stats, it's difficult to remember that McLaren looked second best to Williams for much of the season. Senna's extraordinary run of 4 wins, all from pole at the start of the season, was made all the more impressive because he was battling some car gremlin or other for most of them. A mid-season dip in form looked like it might spell the end for the team's title hopes, but they don't stay down for long, and 3 more wins, all again from pole, got Senna over the line. Berger, for his part, had another disappointing season, having to be presented with his first win in 2 years on a platter, but despite car troubles, he seems to be enjoying life at McLaren and looking forward to his third year there. Tyrrell Honda, 6th with 12 points. Car number 3, Satoru Nakajima, 15th with 2 points. Car number 4, Stefano Modena, 8th with 10 points. There was much cause for optimism for Tyrrell at the start of 1991, with a neat chassis that had done well in Alesi's hands, the powerful and reliable Honda V10, and the highly rated Stefano Modena, but despite early promise, it all turned out to be less than the sum of its parts. Nakajima had a shocker of a season, Modena looked increasingly disillusioned with the whole thing, and the main culprit, ironically, was the engine, much heavier than the little Ford V8 the car was designed around, it threw the balance out completely. After yet another season of unfulfilled promise, it's hardly surprising to hear that Ken Tyrrell is willing to listen to offers. Williams Renault, 2nd with 125 points. Car 5, Nigel Mansell, 2nd with 72 points. Car 6, Riccardo Patrese, 3rd with 53 points. For most of the 1991 season, the FW14 was the fastest thing on the track, but it was the time it spent off the track that proved more decisive. As Patrese ruefully observed while Senna was powering through car issues to win in the opening 4 races, Williams recorded 3 retirements each from those same 4 races. Once the initial reliability woes were mostly sorted out, there was a good run of form, but by then the team were playing catch-up, and even as they were winning, Senna was still scoring points and reducing them to chipping slowly away at his lead. It's to Mansell's credit that he took the championship down to the penultimate race, but his critics point to his last lap retirement in Canada and his ignominious exit in Japan as evidence that he just doesn't have the temperament and focus to win. He was certainly dominated in qualifying by Patrese early on, and despite catching up a bit, his number 2 still outqualified him by 9-7 and won 2 races. A good season for Patrese, and you can understand him being a bit miffed to still be down the pecking order. Brabham Yamaha. Car number 7, Martin Brundle, 17th with 2 points. Car number 8, Mark Blundell, 19th with 1 point. Like Tyrrell, early signs looked good, with both cars usually qualifying and finishing as high as 8th, but all the usual small budget reliability issues came in during the mid-season and prevented them doing better. Dropping into pre-qualifying was annoying, but didn't prove a major hurdle as they only failed to make it through once, Blundell in Japan, and usually contrived to qualify somewhere in the late teens and early 20s. The late season saw reliability improve once more, and this was rewarded with points finishes for Blundell in Belgium and Brundle in Japan. Martin will look forward to having better car under him next year, but Mark acquitted himself very well, and although out of a Brabham seat on financial grounds, will be hoping to find a drive for next year. Footwork Porsche and Footwork Ford, 0 points. Car number 9, Michele Alboreto. Car number 10, Alex Caffey and Stefan Johansson. The Footwork team were another one looking forward to their season after securing the sought-after Porsche V12, and like Tyrrell, it turned out to be a disappointment. Unlike Tyrrell, the Footwork Porsche never looked like it even might be a bit good, either failing to qualify or failing to finish. The replacement of the overweight, underpowered Porsche with a lighter Ford V8 helped a little, but not much, as the car had been designed around the bigger engine and there was no money for a redraw. Things weren't helped by Alex Caffey having a massive falling out with the team after his post-Monaco road accident, but ironically it was Alex that got the team's best result, 10th in Japan, one of just 4 finishes all year. Alboreto was usually faster in qualifying, though all that meant was that he got to drive a few laps before breaking down. Still, he signed up for next season alongside Aguri Suzuki with those ex-Tyrrell Honda engines. What could possibly go wrong? Lotus Judd, 9th place with 3 points. Car number 11, Mika Hakkinen, 16th place with 2 points. Car number 12, Julian Bailey, Johnny Herbert and Martel Bartels. Julian Bailey came 23rd with 1 point. If there were points for making up places during a race, Lotus would have been in with a shot at the Constructors' title. Most famously, Hakkinen and Bailey's drives from 25th and 26th on the grid to 5th and 6th at the flag at Imola, but there were a dozen less fated drives, most recently Johnny Herbert managing to go from 21st to 11th in just 14 laps at a drenched Adelaide, almost entirely unnoticed in the circumstances. Herbert and Hakkinen are both good drivers and will be assets to the team next year, especially if Johnny is finally able to get a full season under his belt, but much will depend on what engine is in the back. This year's Judd was reasonably reliable, but just lacked grunt. If the team can maintain that knack for climbing the field, but from a better starting position, they might do well in 1992. Fonmetal Ford, 0 points. Car number 14, Olivier Guillard and Gabriele Tarquini. Gabriele Rumi is said to already be regretting his decision to buy into F1, finding that success is not easy to come by. Much of the problem, of course, is the lack of resources available to the former Azzella team. And apart from Rumi's own Fonmetal concern, the car has been almost entirely sponsor-free most of the year, which won't have helped. The new chassis and the creation of Fomet in the UK suggested hope for the future, but much will depend on who is driving next year. Guillard earned few friends, while Tarquini did better, albeit against reduced opposition in pre-qualifying, once AGS had fallen by the wayside. Leighton House Ilmore. 12th, 1 point. Car number 15, Maurizio Gugelmin. Car number 16, Ivan Capelli and Carl Wendlinger. Capelli, 20th, with 1 point. A potentially catastrophic season for the team, as not only was their performance woeful on track, but their title sponsor exited in the most spectacular fashion possible, the owner imprisoned for massive financial fraud, which, given the reports about footwork turning down the Ilmor engine deal, has potentially rendered them toxic to other Japanese investors as well. And it's the Japanese who are still the big investors in F1 at the moment. With Capelli already out and question marks over Gugelmin too, the team face a very uncertain future, as caretaker bosses try to find a way to continue into 1992. If this is the end, it's such a shame for a team that looked for a while as if it might really shake up the F1 grid. AGS Ford. 0 points. Car 17, Gabriele Tarquini and Olivier Guillard. Car number 18, Stefan Johansson and Fabrizio Barbazza. And so farewell to the brave little garagistes from the south of France. Eighth place in Phoenix seemed to bode well, but that was unfortunately their only finish all year, one of just three races the car started. Another change of ownership, a new chassis, a new paint job, a new driver in Barbazza, nothing seemed to work, and the team were usually found languishing right at the back of qualifying, and only ahead of Colony once they dropped into PQ. They've been a popular addition to the paddock and made lots of friends along the way, but as many teams have found out before them, and no doubt many will later, you can't keep an F1 team running if you can't even get into the race. Au revoir, Automobile Gonferonnaise Sportive. Benetton Ford. 4th place, 38.5 points. Car number 19, Nelson Piquet. 6th place with 26.5 points. Car number 20, Roberto Moreno and Michael Schumacher. Moreno 10th on 8 points, Schumacher 14th on 4 points. A decent season for Benetton, and for a while it looked as if they might push Ferrari for 3rd place, but that was more due to Ferrari's weakness than their strength, and despite the promise of the radical-looking B191 chassis, there's a sense that Benetton stagnated a bit this year. Piquet's good luck in Canada aside, they never really looked much like they were in the hunt for wins, and it's possible that the main problem was in the cockpit, as Piquet got more and more demotivated and, with the best will in the world, Roberto Moreno just didn't live up to his spectacular debut for the team. He was no doubt badly treated in the Schumacher situation, but the arrival of the young German seemed to be a shot in the arm for the team, and he certainly seemed to push Piquet harder than Moreno ever had. All that said, though, despite his talent, it's still a bit of a gamble for the team to have appointed him as number one driver for next year. BMS Scuderia Italia Dallara Judd. 8th place, 5 points. Car number 21, Emanuele Pirro. 18th place, with 1 point. Car number 22, JJ Leto. 12th place, with 4 points. Not bad on the face of it. 8th in the standings with 5 points. Though it's worth remembering that 4 of those points came from one result, Leto's fine podium at Imola. The rest of the season was less distinguished, with the exclusive Judd V10 engine proving problematic, and the whole package just not quite quick enough to look like scoring regularly, even when not breaking down. Experienced McLaren test and Benetton race driver Pirro disappointed a little in his first full season, failing to pre-qualify three times, even if he did out-qualify Leto over the season as a whole, while it was the Finn that always seemed to have the car trouble. Next season they've abandoned those Judds for Ferrari power. Let's see if they have the wherewithal to make more use of it than Minardi. Minardi Ferrari, 7th place with 6 points. Car number 23, Pierluigi Martini, 11th place with 6 points. Car number 24, Gianni Morbidelli and Roberto Moreno. Both scored, but with other teams. Speaking of Minardi, a slightly better season than their compatriots in red, as Pierluigi Martini's 2 fourth places in San Marino and Portugal gave them a point more, but again it was a tale of mostly toiling away in midfield, occasionally appearing somewhere in the top 6 during the race and breaking down a lot. Here it seemed to be the transmission rather than the engine itself that was fragile. Martini did his usual solid job for little reward, and wasn't a completely ridiculous shout for Ferrari seat, while prancing horse tester Morbidelli acquitted himself well enough in his first season, even if he did save his best drive, 6th place and half a point in the Adelaide monsoon, for his primary employers. Next year Minardi will have those Lamborghini V12s that have been passed around the midfield a lot. They've got grunt and most of the kinks have been worked out by now, but they're not exactly top of the line and the team's many fans aren't optimistic. Ligier Lamborghini. 0 points. Car 25, Thierry Boutsen. Car 26, Eric Comas. One of the current operators of those Lamborghinis has had another pretty undistinguished season. A bona fide race winner in Thierry Boutsen, a very highly rated rookie driver in Eric Comas, and the big grunty V12s all made absolutely no difference as the de facto French national team continued to flounder embarrassingly. The team haven't now scored a point since Olivier Guillard came home 6th at Paul Ricard in 1989, and the team actually failed to qualify more times in 1991, 3, than in 1990, once. Guy Ligier is looking to the future though, and has spent most of the year very publicly putting together what he hopes will be a winning package with engine parity with Williams and a raft of technical and financial support thanks to the efforts of the French state. The big question for 1992 is whether the newly unemployed Alain Prost will come on board in some capacity. Ferrari. 3rd, 55.5 points. Car number 27, Alain Prost and Gianni Morbidelli. Prost 5th with 34 points, Morbidelli 24th with half a point. Car 28, Jean Alesi. 7th place, 21 points. Ferrari's first winless season since 1986, and as usual when things are going wrong on track, the team dissolves into factionalism and recrimination under the merciless gaze of the Italian sporting press. There's always a high-profile scapegoat, and this time there were two, with both Cesare Fiorio and Alain Prost paying the price for the lack of success. The 642 chassis with which the team began the year was something of a disaster, despite Prost coming second on its debut in Phoenix, but while the 643 was a rush job, it seemed to improve matters for a while. Prost's big complaint this year was a lack of development on the 643 once it was introduced, and it certainly seemed to fall further and further behind as the season developed into a two-way scrap between Williams and McLaren. Jean Alesi, for his part, kept his head down and his nose clean, and probably did as well as could be expected under the circumstances, for all that the fans were longing for a bit of on-track fireworks from him. LaRousse Lola Ford. 11th place, 2 points. Car number 29, Eric Bernard and Bertrand Gachot. Bernard 22nd with 1 point. Car number 30, Aguri Suzuki, 21st with 1 point. Gerard LaRousse's team spent much of the season living from hand to mouth as they scrabbled for sponsor backing. More Japanese investment seems to have staved off the creditors at least, and for 1992 the team are due to go back to the Lamborghini engines they helped develop. This year saw a lot of transmission and gearbox problems, so that's something to look at for next year, and there's a big question mark over drivers too. The incoming Ukio Katayama has done well in Japan, but is a rookie in F1, while Eric Bernard's broken ankle presumably means the team will have to at least start the season with someone else in the cockpit. But who will fancy a potentially temporary seat at a struggling backmarker team? Plenty of people, of course. There's never a shortage of willing drivers. Sponsors willing to pay for it, though, can be another matter entirely. Coloni Ford, 0 points. Car 31, Pedro Chavez and Naoki Hattori. And it's Ciao Coloni as Enzo bows out after 4 and a bit years of effort for very little reward. The team have never scored a point, haven't finished a race since 1988, and haven't qualified for one since 1989. It's a wonder they kept going at all, and they've had some tidy drivers in that time with Roberto Moreno, Gabriele Tarquini and Bertrand Gachot. Pedro Chavez never really stood much of a chance, to be honest, Naoki Hattori even less so, and the Portuguese driver in particular will be hoping he can get something else to allow him to show his talent to better effect. As for the future of the Coloni team, the new owner Andrea Sassetti seems to be a bit of a mystery, and it's unknown exactly what his plans for the team are. Jordan Ford, 5th place, 13 points. Car number 32, Bertrand Gachot, Michael Schumacher, Roberto Moreno and Alessandro Zanardi. Gachot placed 13th with 4 points, Schumacher and Moreno both scored points but only for Benetton. Car number 33, Andrea De Cesaris, 9th place, 9 points. Unquestionably the surprise success story of 1991, the green cars operated by the charismatic but shrewd Irishman Eddie Jordan turned heads all around the world, with Andrea De Cesaris surely in line for a Most Improved Driver award, thanks apparently to lots of one-on-one work from Eddie. The Gachot situation remains a little murky, but Zanardi did well in the last few races too. The team benefited from top-line Ford engines, starting off on parity with Benetton, though they didn't receive the mid-season update, but for next year Flavio Briatore has persuaded Ford to cut off that particular tap, so they'll have to make do with ex-Brabham Yamahas, which will probably be a distinct downgrade. Stefano Modena comes on board from Tyrrell, presumably in place of Zanardi in the lead car, but whether De Cesaris will stick around or move on is unknown. Modena, Lamborghini. 0 points. Car 34, Nicola Larini. Car 35, Eric van der Poel. Things started so promisingly, with Larini finishing 7th in Phoenix and van der Poel within a lap of points at Imola before his car broke, but with the almost total lack of either support or interest from the parent firm, it was inevitable that they would slip further back down the grid. Lamborghini just never really wanted an F1 team. They only bought out the Glass project to salvage their investment. The whole sorry affair is perhaps a very good example of the sunk cost fallacy. Nicola Larini is a talented driver and will hope to find a better berth, while the jury is still out on van der Poel. Undoubtedly something about him from his Imola performance in his F3000 years, but he's still to make an impression at this level. He has signed up for Brabham next year, but given their problems, it might be a case of out of the frying pan and into the fire.